that they begin to plot how to arrest him and put him to death. It is this event of raising Lazarus from the dead that most scares those who are in charge of the status quo. And this is the one that begins the final end game for Jesus. So there is immediately in the air a threatening tone. And Jesus goes away from there and is away for a while. We don't know when this story happens in relationship to it time-wise. Maybe it's a few days, maybe it's a few weeks, but it's fresh. And so today's story finds him back in Bethany. And the miraculous fact that at this table where he is sitting, where they have decided to hold a dinner for him, at this party sits Lazarus. You can imagine, perhaps, all the emotion of this moment. This man, Lazarus, who must still be dazed by what has happened to him, is sitting at the very table where days or weeks before they have sat around and mourned his death. They have sat around and cried and come to terms with the fact that he was dead and gone. And now he's sitting here at this table again. And Martha is serving the meal because that seems to be Martha's role. And he is sitting at the table. And everyone is seated at around the table, either on the ground or on small stools. And there are others there. There are some of the disciples, obviously, and there are some others who have come to Mary in her grief and in her joy. And as that meal begins, Mary comes up with a jar of costly ointment, we're told. Ointment which would have cost her probably a year's wages to buy. And she comes up and takes some of that ointment and puts it on her hands and rubs it into his feet and rubs his feet with her hair. As intimate a thing as a woman and a man could do together who were not married. Women did not touch men, and they did not show their hair. And here they are in this moment of intense intimacy. It's a beautiful moment. It's one we are to cling to. And its root is in what happened before. Because when Mary and Martha had come out to Jesus and said that he's dead, and he says, "I am the resurrection and the life," they now know what that means. They know on a deep level what it means that Jesus is the resurrection and the life, on a more personal level than you can otherwise know. They don't intellectually know what this means. They didn't figure out how Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. They just know he did. And Mary pours out this ointment in, certainly in thanksgiving, but in so much more than thanksgiving. In awe, in love, in adoration, because this is not just a man who did something good for the family. This is a man who, in doing that, overcame the power of death with his power of life. And now, at this moment, when the shadow of death and conflict, which is to come in Jerusalem just across the valley in a matter of days, when that dark shadow is so prevalent surrounding the neighborhood, surrounding the house, in the midst of that, Mary knows what it means. Mary knows that Jesus is facing the end of his life now and will be buried. And she takes this ointment, which is intended to be his burial ointment, and the ointment that's put on his body when he is wrapped in a burial shroud. And he takes this ointment, she takes it, and she puts it on him now. It is her statement of faith that though this death is about to come, it doesn't matter. It's her statement of understanding that in Jesus, there is no distinction between life and death. In Jesus, life is what is triumphant. That you can wrap him in the shrouds of death. You can anoint him with the oil of burial, and he will live. It's an extravagant and loving act. And then there is the voice of Judas. Judas, who says, hey, wait a second, that could have been sold for a lot of money. We could have given it away to the poor. You know that voice. You know that person who just doesn't get it, who's got this sort of insecurity, who is so obsessed with following the rules that they can't get a moment of grace that transcends the rules. His voice is the voice of reality. He is the one who will now come and be the one who betrays Jesus. He is the one who will set everything else in motion. That's the voice that breaks into this quiet scene in which Mary says nothing. That voice of the impending death and what will come next. So we're given on this day in our lives, this fifth Sunday of Lent, we're given this exquisite moment in Jesus' life, this exquisite moment in Mary and Martha, Lazarus' life, when in the face of death and destruction and fear and anger, there is this act of overwhelming generosity, ridiculous pouring out of love. And that is what in our world, in this moment, we are called to as well. We live in a world, you know, that's surrounded by fear and death and darkness. Who knows what's going to happen next? But in that moment, we can do the extravagant acts of love that Mary could do. You and I are able to reach out beyond all reasonableness and bring God's love into this world and in people's lives. I don't know what it would mean for you to do an extravagant act of love. I'm not sure what it means for me, but I know that on this Sunday, that's what you and I are called to. In the face of the darkness of the world, simply and with all our heart and with all our joy and all our awe and all our thanksgiving, to love beyond measure.